So that being my short and brief introduction, we'll go to the topic of interest. Before we move to the topic of interest, there are some certain basic facts that we need to look at about PPH. One is every other woman who has crossed 20 weeks, the legal time for abortion, is a candidate for PPH, whatever be the predisposing factors present or not. And the next thing is that anything which you consider as a minor PPH in your clinical setting can progress to a major PPH very fast. So the minor trickle, the moderate lochia, all this needs to be evaluated much better at times. And the blood loss sometimes can be underestimated. And if it is underestimated, we have a problem in clinical management at the conservative level itself. And it may be well tolerated at the same time. So it provides a huge conundrum of deficient data at that point when the blood loss is underestimated. Now this, I don't know, I picked this slide from the internet. How they estimated, I am wondering myself. But it has been estimated that within 2 hours, untreated PPH death occurs. So that probably amongst all your problems related to labor would be the shortest time in which to react itself. So keep that in mind as part. These three slides almost form the basis of my further talk. Now coming to this question, when do we seek help? It's a very broad spectrum out there, from primary PPH, secondary, late PPH. So the timing is usually decided on the obstetric side more often than being decided by the IR side people. But suffices to say from my own experience that you should start from any point where you see the bleeding, right up to early DIC, we are here to solve the problem. But something going beyond early DIC is a bad prognostic factor. The second point which I have noticed is that whenever a patient has consistently breached the renal perfusion pressure, you have a bad prognosis already there. So hopefully with all this, we will now come to exactly a pictorial essay from where we will decide where all what happened in specific cases. The most major and important thing is whether it's an in-house referral or a referral from outside. In-house referral would be the most ideal situation, but does not occur, as you all know. Because having an IR man, having a cath lab free in the same hospital as the delivery is occurring is not an ideal situation which most hospitals or many of you are working under. So when there is a referral from outside, there starts a problem which I also don't have control, you also don't have control. That is the transport logistics. This is a scene from one of the ambulances being stuck out there. Now what is shock to an interventional radiologist? Other than the other kinds of shock, this is what is shock out there. So here I'll try to point out this was a problem which they have solved. That's fantastic, it's working well. So this is a male patient, if you see the name there you will realize, but had a pelvic tumor bleed. And his BP was at 70 mm mercury when I took him up for angio. Look at this, I have punctured the right femoral, crossed across, you see the common iliac here. External iliac, internal iliac. Look at the thread-like nature of the external iliac as it goes to become the femoral artery. So one important point which you need to notice is that to puncture the femoral artery itself, it may take some time in the interventional cath lab. It's not an easy job. So we'll go run through a few cases as quickly as possible. And this is one of those cases which is the standard primary PPH, where the baby delivered early morning 3:30. Lady went through, patient went through 2 episodes of bleeding by evening, not yet recovered. And then there is a question on the conservative management being responsive or not. And usually all these referrals tend to come to the IR cath lab towards night, towards weekends, and this is a common phenomenon across the bleeding spectrum across the body. So this is how a PPH would look like. This is the uterine artery as it originates. I'm trying to use this. This is the first time I'm using this kind of technique. There you see as it goes along, the proximal part is tortuous, hypertrophied, enlarged, and there are certain pseudoaneurysms also which can be there. And this is a very difficult cannulation because there is a reverse U bend out there. Thankfully, as of now, we have good catheters and microcatheters which can take us to almost any artery in the pelvis, which was unheard of maybe 10 years ago. We used to find it difficult. We used to waste a lot of time on that. So this being the picture on various sequential arterial images, as you see, you can see corkscrew appearance radially going around the uterus into the myometrium and this kind of thing. This is at various stages of embolization that I have managed to finish. You can see the uterine artery is just now residually seen as a small U bend here. And the end of embolization is simply a fact that the other branches are filling better of the internal iliac than the uterine artery per se. That is the definitive. There is no need for absolute cutoff of the uterine artery to be achieved in any circumstance. So this you see here is the enlarged image of the end point of embolization, where this U is the start of the uterine artery and it has adequately slowed down enough to give us the effect of controlled of hemorrhage. Now when I go to the other side, the same side, you have a similar situation. The same tortuosities which I showed you in the left uterine artery are there in the right uterine artery as well. One thing which you should notice here is that this last frame, the uterine artery fills on the right, there is cross flow going across to the left uterine artery branch. This is a very important to emphasize a simple point, that there is nothing called unilateral uterine artery embolization. It always has to be bilateral, otherwise it will recruit supply from the other side and bleeding might continue. And technically it is unheard of being unable to cannulate both sides with the present catheters and other paraphernalia that we have now. So this also continues through its embolization sequence, and we end up at a point where we have achieved, as you can see in the lower image, stasis in the uterine artery proximal branches. And generally we tend to leave a better part of the uterine artery on one side at least for the further neovascularization to set in, so the uterus gains its blood supply later on. Now we'll come to another case. This was a lady who was operated caesarean in a town nearby to Bangalore and was referred upon continuous bleeding within a week or so to an obstetrician in Bangalore. And here conservative management was instituted and everything worked well for 3 days. On the morning on the rounds, it was decided by the obstetric team, okay, let us discharge this patient, she is in safe zone. She mobilized herself to get active and be discharged. At that point, she suddenly collapsed. And upon collapse, the vaginal pads were found to be completely wet and blood soaked. So at this point, this was referred to me and I took up the case. And this is how you see one uterine artery, the right uterine artery here. Again, the same tortuous hypertrophied vascularity, which after embolization will be seen like this. We still leave a bit of the proximal. There is no absolute cutoff being achieved at any point. Same was the situation on the other side as well. This was one case which unfortunately, probably she bled too much, late referral, lot of problems did occur. She breached the renal perfusion pressure quite a few times and I was called in on a Sunday. And other than the uterine artery, in this you see is bleeding is occurring from an extra uterine branch. We all know that collaterals do develop during pregnancy, and the major part of the bleed was from this extra uterine branch, which was there. As you can see, this is the early part of the run I have shown here, and that is the later part of the run. This is a cine run showing the extravasation. Very few times do you see the extravasation. Oh, bhaiya, ye nikal gaya? Nahi, aa gaya. Okay. This is the early part when the extravasation starts, and this is where the extravasation is continuing. This was also embolized in addition to the uterine artery on that side. And look at the other side when I come, a similar branch is seen, the small branch which goes and shows a small extravasation which increases as the angio run progresses. Further notice that this uterine artery is still here and it is in spasm at certain segment. This part is spasmogenic. In spite of the spasm, you have to go ahead and embolize with vasodilators at that point, giving minimally. We use NTG normally 100 microns or so. And as you come to the lower segment pictures, you see the slowed down uterine artery, this one, the middle one, and this branch which was supplying that blush which is seen in the above series. Now this is a case I never get tired of speaking because this was my first case in Bangalore. And this had a harrowing tale to it. This lady had bled after a caesarean section 5 episodes, 14 units of blood transfusion given, and finally the surgeons in a nearby town across Andhra Karnataka border took her up for surgery. And the obstetric team was trying to do something or probably salvage the uterus in some way. It was noticed that the uterus was badly struck to the urinary bladder. So at that point, a surgical team with some urology experts, since it was a small town, they also came into the picture. They tried their best, if possible, to separate, but finally gave it up and then let it be. And after that, this patient was referred across to Bangalore for this intervention. As you can see, this is a full-fledged aortogram. You see this uterine artery here, this entire area, and then this is the other side uterine artery. It has a lot of tortuosity, pseudoaneurysmal dilatations and all that. And this is the aortogram I have done after the procedure has ended. Now, what I am trying to tell is that this was there since such a long time that I expected vascularity to also be huge, and that is what is seen. Huge amount of vascularity from both the uterine arteries, the right and the left. And after slowing down at some midway point of embolization, this picture has been taken. And this left uterine artery, when almost the embolization has ended for this side. And now coming to this case, this lady had an unusual history, which I came to know of obviously after the procedure. She was in no clinical condition to speak with me when I took her up. So this lady had a classical history that whenever she coughs, she feels something is going wrong and she starts bleeding. So all this was conservatively managed 3 episodes after a cesarean section on her 3rd pregnancy. And the reason is obvious in the angiogram. Have a look at the lower angiograms. This one, this is a CINI, this is the DSA. She has large pseudoaneurysms here, 2 to 3 of them. What is this? Pseudoaneurysm don't have the normal wall of an arterial, this thing, vessel. So what happens is whenever she coughs, the thrombus gets disturbed and the leak starts. So it was classical in this case that she was complaining intra-abdominal pressure variation due to cough. And here, if somebody can notice it, there is a semilunar shaped contrast extravasation here. That is blood which has leaked out of the pseudoaneurysm. With that, we come almost to the end of what the spectrum would be from primary to late PPH. But is there something new developing? That is where we are interested in at the moment. Preventive intervention radiology. Can we be prepared, especially with respect to high-risk pregnancy, one of the themes of this conference being so? Here, I have been in cooperation with one specific team, OBG team, and we have had a series of 3 cases only at the average rate of just 1 per year. I'll go to through the history of these 3 cases and then we'll discuss only one of them. So this was a 25-year-old lady, 9th month of pregnancy, with a large 10-centimeter fibroid was also there, right anterolateral, lower uterine. She was grossly obese, 113 kg, BMI was 47. LSCS was planned. There was risk of bleeding for the delivery itself. The delivery obviously had become precious in a way. And plus or minus myomectomy was discussed between me and the obstetrician. Preventive standby, balloon occlusion, which was just coming up at that time. So in these kind of patients, when they are usually obese, to hit the femoral artery itself is a Herculean task. So passive Doppler marking was done. And this is the second case, 32-year-old lady, central asymmetric placenta previa, preventive standby angio intervention requested. Third one is what I will be discussing in detail. Standby obstetric intervention requested. Uterine artery balloon catheter management was requested for this lady. She was admitted initially in another hospital, so the maturation of the lung had to be achieved by steroid injections, as you all know. In that hospital, the standby was a vascular surgeon. But on the day it was planned, it was to be shifted to the intervention site. That was on 16 Jan, date mentioned there. Bilateral punctures have their own difficulties, like I mentioned. I won't go into that, except to note that here the patient was also short, 5 feet only. And this is the specific uterine artery injection. And I'm sure none of you would have seen the vascularity angiographically of the placenta. This is how it looks here, the proximal circulation, and as the arterial sequencing progresses on, this is how the placenta exactly sitting at the internal os. So what we do is that when I got this first case, the obesity one, I didn't even have the balloons to occlude them. So there was a huge controversy as to what, because an occlusal balloon has to be just a small rounded thing which will just touch the intima and close off. But there were no such balloons available from the industry. So the only option I had was to use the angiography balloons, take a short segment as possible so that the intimal damage is minimal, and use them only. And you don't need to go to the angioplasty pressures, which are 8 to 10 atmospheres. You just have to do an occlusal pressure, the 4th point there, 4 atmospheres. So this is where we are. We are doing a test injection. Those two points which you see here are the balloon ends, proximal end and the distal end. That is on right uterine, this is the left uterine. This is a test injection going on, and we do a test occlusion also sequentially. This is a test occlusion being done on the right side. You see the balloon inflated just to the atmosphere so that it just touches the intima. This is also the same thing. Now the sequence that went in came in obviously happens in the operation theater. The baby is brought out. Occlusion is provided, in this case was provided for 50 minutes. Though now there is a standardized recommendation according to a body in UK that every 20 minutes you should occlude and then give a release time so that the uterus does get some perfusion intervally also. But in this case, I did do at that point of time 50 minutes. The placenta was found to be adherent, removed piecemeal. In spite of the occlusion support, patient still bleeds profusely. The reason is there is a capillary level bleed and a venous back bleed for close to the, but per of the surgical control was excellent after that 20 minutes. No fall in BP was documented. Blood mixed fluid loss was approximately 2.5 liters. And vaginal packing, intrauterine Foleys, all those were inserted as protective measures for the post-procedure care, post-LSCS care. HB had gone down. She was about 10 when we took her up for the angio intervention, balloon placement. She had gone down to 7.8, 4 units blood, 3 units FFP. Next morning removed, no fresh bleeding. No embolization was further required as part of the post-CS 24-hour period. No embolization. And generally what I do is I remove the uterine balloons and one side femoral arterial sheath within a few hours, because most obstetricians would like to start the DVT profile axis. So I don't want to have a situation where they have introduced Clexair and I am removing the femoral sheath and you have a bleed there. Removed after. In the first case, remember the first case I told was a morbidly obese lady with a huge large fibroid out there. In fact, the blood vascular field was so good that the surgeon looked across to me and said, can I go ahead with the myomectomy? I said, I am here to occlude the uterine, so as well finish it off. So her other problem of a huge fibroid was also dealt with in that situation. Now, there were some lessons learned over these three cases, which for me also was a new experience because balloon occlusion is not often asked by anyone. There is a talk between obstetrician and an interventionist to ask for, get a femoral sheath in and wait for us to do the intervention. But that is of no use as patient bleeds torrentially during shift from OT to cath lab. You heard that being mentioned in the previous speakers also. So unless you have a hybrid cath lab. What is a hybrid cath lab? A hybrid cath lab is an OT cum cath lab. So the OT you work, the cath lab I work. So everything can be done in one place. Only then you can do this kind of things. So you can continue intervention. There are certain things about the balloon specificity placement, what the uterine artery specific, or it should just be in the branch which uterine artery arises from. I would personally, after these three cases, have come to the conclusion I should have in the uterine artery specific, and I should preferably have a O35 balloon which has a larger lumen than an O18 balloon. The reason being, an O35 balloon will allow me to send particles, 300 to 500 micron PVA particles, without even bothering about an angiogram. It's a blind embolization. And that can be done in the cath lab. 5 to 6 syringes of PVA particles can be done if there were to be bleeding also. That is one advantage is what I have learned over these three cases. To summarize, I did mention at the start that failure of conservative management is what brings the patient across to my side. The answer is that word failure, I think, is not apt. What should be that is the conservative management is the whole basis on which this whole procedure runs. Well, intervention just comes in an adjunct in between. The conservative management continues during the intervention and as well as post-interventions as well. Only thing I can tell to an audience of this nature is please sound your IR team, whoever they might be, the nearest point or whatever. Because there are a lot of things that need to be prepared in one, the IR gets mentally prepared. The cath lab technician gets ready. He has to check out the catheter availability as well as the material availabilities. And with that, my acknowledgements to the team with which I did, Dr. Lata Venkatram and her obstetric team, Rangadore Memorial Hospital. Thank you very much for a patient hearing.